Drs. Carrie and
Cheeky
Wood here to explain to you why we do discipleship in what we call triads. Triads means three or three people. And we have found that because God is a relational being, He's wired us as relational beings, spirit, soul, and body, but He's wired us to be in relationship with one another. He's commanded us to love one another as we've received His love. We have found that we grow the best, the fastest, the surest when we learn in relationship. In fact, sociologist named Comer says there's no significant learning in humanity except through relationships. So we've begun to find ways to gather people together. We have them scattered all over the nation now and some in other nations where people are beginning to find the dynamic growth and transformation that happens in what we call a triad. You want to explain to us a little bit about what that's like and why the triad's better?
Yes, and I'll go back to some people ask when they hear about the Abba journey and they hear about the books, the Abba trilogy, they want to find out how can I get the most out of that. And so the Abba journey is the workbook that is designed to go in these in small groups initially. The reason we talk about triads, we actually borrowed that from Greg Ogden, who did a lot of studies about different ways of doing discipleship, different ways of having Bible studies and things that would lead to transformation, yes. Not just to a transfer of information, but transformation. I actually tested that in my doctoral thesis as well, where we tried the same curriculum in an intensive class, in a six-week class, and in small groups, and found out that it was significantly better in small groups. So why three? What's so magical about the number three? Well, when you have mentoring that happens one-on-one, the dynamic tends to be the teacher and the novice, the expert and the one who's asking the questions, the one who has the questions, and the communication always goes in one direction.
And it looks like this. You're doing the talking, and I'm nodding.
Yes,
right?
Exactly. So once you insert a third person into the equation, now that person may be answering one of the questions or maybe providing some input that ministers to the other participant as well. So, oh, now you're not just receiving from the teacher, you're receiving from one another. Then when the other one speaks, then maybe the teacher's hearing something about the exchange between these two and the teacher receives something as well. So the number three then creates this dynamic of everybody has something to contribute. Everybody is necessary. Everybody's important. Nobody can hide behind somebody else. Another downside of the one-on-one mentoring that I want to bring out is that because there's nobody there to judge the relationship, it can open the door to spiritual abuse. It doesn't mean that it necessarily turn into spiritual abuse, but that it could happen. Once you have a third person there, you have more of a safeguard for
it's
that.
It's my way or the highway. You're going to believe it the way I say it, or you're going to be wrong.
Right, and that could be really damaging in some situations. So once you have a third person, it breaks that dynamic.
So what could be the advantage of three, a triad, over, say, a small group, a five or seven or ten?
Yeah, so you can have it with a little bit larger group, but the idea is with three, everybody's voice is significant. Everybody's voice is necessary. Once you add a fourth person to the equation, one of them is not really essential, not really necessary. So what we've seen is that when we have groups of four or more, there'll be one or two who sit back, observe, and let the others do all the talking. And the ones who observe may be getting some information, but not really the process of transformation.
Because they're not engaged.
Exactly.
They're not giving and receiving. Mm-hmm. And then once they feel like they can kind of sit back, then what happens next week when they had a rough week at work and, you know,
They'll skip out.
Yeah, they can skip. They think, I'm not essential to the group anyway. I can miss and they'll still be okay.
Exactly. So the beauty of the triad is really again, that everybody is essential. Everybody has something to contribute. And in that dynamic, in that exchange, everybody's transformed. And what's amazing is we've heard so many testimonies, we've seen it ourselves, how the presence of the Lord comes and the Holy Spirit is the agent of transformation. So I wanted you to touch a little bit on that as well, because people ask us, how do you do trials? So you just get together and answer the questions or what? And you've established a really good pattern of the three-legged table. Let's talk about that.
We call it a three-legged table. We actually have a three-legged table in our living room at home where we do a lot of our discipling. Three-legged table simply means effective transformational discipling happens when you have these three key components. First of the three-legged table is welcoming the presence. You know, there's no transformation that happens spiritually without the presence of God. His presence is the transformational power. We say the Holy Spirit is the active ingredient to our transformation. So the first thing we do when we gather is we just welcome His presence. We'll sing, we'll worship, we'll pray, and we just welcome Him to come. And when we do, now our hearts are open, He's there. He said, wherever two or three of you are gathered, I'm there. So we welcome His presence. Then we get into the truth. What is the truth that the Lord wants to talk to us about this week? Now, this will morph a little bit from one week to the next. One week, it may be a lot of worship and we don't have as much time for another part, but all three are significant. Most of the time, the truth is always in the middle. It's the meat of the sandwich. What is the Holy Spirit saying? Well, that's the chapter of the book that we're learning about that week. The third leg of the table is relationship. Because God is a relational being and He's made us as relational beings, we want to exercise that relationship by ministering to one another. So we'll take the last 15 or 20 minutes of our time together and just say, what's going on in your life? Is there something we can pray with you about? And we'll actually take time to minister to one another. And in that triad setting, that's a confidential setting where I can share my heart with my brothers. You can share your heart with your sisters, and it doesn't go anywhere else. And we lift that up to the Lord and care about each other. Well, of course, that becomes more than just a weekly meeting. Now we're checking in with each other, we're texting, how's it going? How about that thing that we prayed about the other night? How did that come out? And relationships get built that last, some of them for a lifetime.
Yeah, I want to touch a little bit on how we do the truth part going through the chapter. Mm-hmm. A lot of people say this becomes very different from a normal Bible study. And this is why we're not as much interested in having the right answer to the questions in the workbook. We're interested in engaging with God and hearing the voice of the Father for ourselves. And so what we share mostly when we come together is how the Holy Spirit has given us revelation, has given us insight through the chapter that we're processing. So we're not looking for right answers versus wrong answers. We're looking for what is God doing in your life through this? What are you getting out of it? And what does that look like in practical ways so that we come together, we come and we paraclete, we come alongside one another in that process of transformation.
Chiki learned about the triads through her doctoral studies. I learned about it through about 30 years of pastoral ministry in a conviction to make disciples. When I was very young, I knew I was supposed to make disciples. And the first time I gathered 20 guys together. And man, I opened up my heart to these 20 guys. But with 20, there's no way they could all open their hearts and feed back to me. And it becomes a toxic relationship. This is mutual indwelling and mutual self-disclosure that we talk about in the training. If I'm doing all the talking and you're just sitting there nodding your head, guess what? If that stays that way, it becomes a toxic relationship. So I have to share a little bit of my heart and then you share a little bit of yours. So 1-on-20 doesn't work. I tried 1-on-12. That doesn't work. I tried 1-on-7. 7's the perfect number. Well, that didn't work. Why? Number one, I'm going out there trying to gather people up. And guess what? If you go gather up people to disciple, you're going to have to go gather them every week. You're going to have to be chasing after them. So with triads, here's three that are very closely related to one another. There's a relationship and a bond that builds, as Chiki has already said. No one person is insignificant. No one person is totally taking the lead. In fact, after just a few weeks, we pass the leadership mm-hmm. of the week around. And I say it this way, if you can have a cup of coffee with somebody, you can make disciples. We encourage you to consider.
Let me add one more thing to that. Sorry, I know you're about to close, but I think this is important too, that Jesus told all of us to go into all the world and make disciples. So one of the things that we want to do in triads is to encourage people that as you are transformed, you can turn around and you can make disciples yourself. So the idea is that we're making disciples who know how to make disciples, who are making disciples, who are making disciples. That is how a movement of discipleship can happen, a movement of sonship, a movement of this renewal to receive the love of the Father and to respond to His presence. And there will be all kinds of evidence of how that transformation takes place in our lives that will have an impact in the world.
And some of you are thinking right now, I could never do that. Well,
yes,
what if you can? What if you get so transformed by the presence of God and by the truth that you're a son, that now you have something to give away and it's a powerful opportunity and a great way to live. We hope that you'll consider it.